Great.
Ah,
very nice meeting you.
Yeah, you too. Just wanted to meet in person.
Great.
Your talks and your students' talks. So.
Yeah. Actually, your slide or one of your work will be cited here.
Oh, okay. Very good.
Yeah, I really hope, you know, I haven't really followed up with Jim. I sent him an email, but eventually I like to see whether there is any opportunity to collaborate. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I think
that would
be really good.
Yeah. So Vijay is not here, not around.
No, I think he's working right now. I'm not sure if he's coming to this particular time.
I see. Okay. All right.
Anyway, looking forward to
your
talk.
Great.
Thanks.
Yeah. Just want to introduce myself. I'm Tom Everhart.
Oh, wow.
40 years ago, I was chairman of your department.
Yes, it's so nice
good
to
see
meet
you. Doing
you.
So well.
Thank you.
Looking
so nice.
To your talk.
Nice meeting you, finally. Trying to get a project. Yes, I do. Yeah. Duplicate. Okay, I think that should work. Let's see whether this is pretty.
I think I'm getting brain dead. So
yeah.
You graduated from Berkeley in 87.
Yes. Don't worry.
And then you were at Belcourt.
Uh-huh. Don't need, yeah.
And then,
short introduction is fine. Maybe you even signed my anything, petition, a mission letter. I don't know. Thank you for admitting me to the program.
All right, we'll get started. We're very pleased today to have Connie Chang-Hasnain give a seminar here. She's a good friend to many of us for many, many years. I remember when she was a grad student at Berkeley. Graduate 87, which is when I came here, so a long time ago. She worked with Chris Palmstrom at Belcor after that for about 5 years, and then went to Stanford University and now UC Berkeley. And she's won lots of awards. It would take too long to read all of them, but a few of them are things like the Nick Holoniak Award, the David Sarnoff Award, the UNESCO Award, Guggenheim Fellowship, Humboldt Research Award. And the nice thing for all of us is that she was editor of JLT for about 6 years, which was a great service, so thank you much for that. So without further ado, Connie will talk about flat photonics using high contrast metastructures.
Thank you very much. Is the recording okay? Okay, but that's not a microphone. I guess I don't need a microphone, right? Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, John, for the introduction. And it's a great pleasure to be here. I have to say I'm such a great admirer of you all, following John and Larry's work very much, so closely, your directions always influence my thinking tremendously. So I want to thank you for that, and thank you, Rod, also today. He reminded me several references I should go and look into, so thank you very much. And so today, I'm sorry to have changed the title a little bit because I figure I would focus on one topic instead of getting into two different topics. So I think I'd like to motivate photonics a little bit, although I know this is the bringing coal to Newcastle. So I really don't need to remind everybody where photonics is. But certainly communications applications, lighting and display. Steve just showed me some really fantastic new possibilities there. And sensing and metrology, particularly with the rise of wearables. I think this is a very, very exciting area, particularly for lasers and photonics. And then I like to say that photovoltaics is still a very interesting topic, despite of the fact that I think today DOE is not funding so much in this country. I'm leading a program in Singapore, called Singapore Berkeley Research Initiative on Sustainable Energy, where we are still working on photovoltaics. In fact, we are going on for the second round of proposal. And this time, I think we are going after energy harvesting for IoT of things and so on. So photovoltaics for indoor. I think that's going to be particularly exciting. And then finally, I think the final frontier is really 3D, both 3D imaging and 3D display. Finally, I think lasers plays a major role in here. Of course, everybody has been following the Google car, the Uber car, and so on and so forth. But I think 3D means a lot more than just that. Maybe it's for the flying vehicle or autonomous vehicle, maybe immediately, but maybe on the, you know, on robots roaming in the home and in manufacturing floor, 3D would be very, very important. So all of those fantastic applications bringing photonics to every day, to all of our personal devices now, but yet a lot of the optics, optical components are still very bulky, very large, particularly the lens and the prisms, gratings, and so on and so forth. So there's obviously a lot of effort and belief that it should be integrated. And certainly, John and Rod and Larry, you guys have led the effort on silicon photonics. And we are also believer of integration, probably onto a silicon or other platform. But certainly, integration would be very, very interesting. To that extent, we've been growing 3-5 compound semiconductor nanopillars directly on silicon with low temperature MOCVD. We actually made some devices and managed to do selective area growth finally. And these pillars are different from nanowires in such way that, number one, it's scalable to 1 micron. Half micron to 1 micron diameter and tens of micron tall and in a few minutes of growth. That's number one difference. Number two, growth temperature is very low, 400 to 450 degrees C. Number three is core shell growth. Most important thing, it's core shell growth. And so the defects are all stacking faults are terminated horizontally in the bottom of the pillars. So we have gotten some really nice results vertically for single crystal wall-like phase. Indium phosphide here, and this is also indium phosphide. You can grow it into a very sharp needle as well. And we made some devices, LEDs, and solar cells, and APDs. But again, today I won't be talking about that. I will be primarily focused on our work on high contrast, high index contrast metastructures. So that brings me back, probably rewind the timeline, to 20 years. We are still working, in short, we are still working on VCSELs, vertical cavity surface emitting lasers, again, following Larry and John's work. That a lot of the advantages that in our early papers that we say, okay, excellent fiber coupling, low power consumption, wafer scale testing, these all came true. And indeed, today, these VCSELs, multi-mode VCSEL as well as single-mode VCSEL, has hit the market in a big way. More than 1 billion units have been deployed, primarily in fiber communications, multi-mode fiber communications, but some of them in printing and other applications. One thing that we like to always say is that because it has a very short cavity, and so therefore a single longitudinal mode, and that can be designed, therefore emission wavelength, and in essence, it's basically like an LED in fabrication and in processing, but it has laser property in coherency in the emission. So it's a fantastic vehicle in that sense. Recently, optical coherent tomography as being a very interesting applications for VCSEL. Previan has been doing a lot of very outstanding work together with Swan Labs and Professor Jim Fujimoto's group at MIT. And of course, LiDAR is another yet possible applications. I believe VCSELs are already in some smartphones, but certainly next generation. And for LiDAR or face ranging applications and so on. So coming back to communications applications, particularly for data centers, shown here is a very early photograph of a Google data center. So that's this dated probably 7-8 years. It leaked out at a time when nobody knew Google was doing fiber networks. And so what was interesting was that they actually showed a lot of fibers, single mode fibers on top. So I always liked this figure or this photo much better than a lot of later fancy pictures because of that. But behind each of the rack, you have those orange cables. And those are, of course, multimode fibers. And behind it, each one of them, we have two VCSELs, one at each end. And so this is, you know, where VCSEL's major market had hit home. It's fantastic multimode A50 nanometer VCSEL. It's inexpensive. But multimode fiber, so it's a very limited distance. And it's not WDM compatible. So therefore, the density, poor density is very poor. As I mentioned, just one per fiber. And then it's not silicon photonics integratable or compatible because it's A50. So possibility of moving to 1.55 micron is still very interesting because you can use the same inexpensive process to make the lasers and using one fiber, so that's single mode fiber, everywhere. So therefore, it's more it's inexpensive. Actually, multimode fiber nowadays, because they have to engineer for higher bandwidth, so it becomes very expensive. In addition, if you use tunable laser, finally, it's DWDM ready and silicon photonics compatible. So all that debate between VCSEL versus silicon photonics, maybe it just means VCSEL needs to go long wavelength. But VCSELs have one challenge that really is still there, and that is the mirrors. And for the longest time, especially for long wavelength VCSEL, it's very tough to get a mirror, which is better than what you want. Metal mirrors are lossy, so not practical to use. The DBR mirrors are very interesting. The traditional DBR, whether you're talking about for VCSEL or any other mirrors, or even for AR coating, for that matter, you use multi-layers of materials. Particularly for mirror, every interface, you have small amount of reflection, and you added them in phase, then you get a lot. So this type of mirrors for 1.55 micron VCSEL, for lattice match to indium phosphide, you need about 60 pairs. And that comes out to be about 12 micron. It's really very thick. And to make one mirror is doable, but not two. But just in general, I just now mentioned the mirror technology has been always layered like that. So therefore, reflection is always in the direction of periodicity. Okay, and that's true for photonic crystal as well, because the band gap and so on is basically stop band, basically reflection. So it's in the direction of periodicity. So we've been wondering, is it possible that you can use lithography to define something so that the periodicity is orthogonal to your beam propagation and therefore replace at least one of the mirrors? So this we are inspired by the Faraday cage. Faraday cage is, of course, for microwave regime, for ENM wave, where metal is basically, loss is negligible, so it's basically perfect conductor, K can be, at least that model can be used. So if you have a mesh and you have certain structure, certain periodicity, frankly speaking, it doesn't need to be periodic, but as long as there's boundary conditions, so E field goes to zero at a mesh, and so therefore it creates the K vector in plane, and that K vector is determined by the structure, the period, and if the beam wavelength is larger than the period, then the vector sum still need to conserve. So kx squared, ky squared will be larger than k naught squared, which is propagation in air. So therefore, kz squared at that boundary would be less than zero. Kz is imaginary, means all light are returned. And indeed, we see this every day in our microwave oven, at least as one example. Recently, I saw one episode of one of those spy shows. I forgot which one it was. So the moment they enter this special room, they put everybody's cell phone into the microwave oven. I don't know. Anybody saw this? Which one? I don't know. It's one of the shows. I thought that was really quite cute. But anyway, so the mirrors basically with holes smaller than the microwave wavelength, so therefore reflects microwave, but it's larger, the holes are larger than visible wavelength, therefore we can see through. So we were wondering, is it possible to have a similar effect using dielectric, although you don't have E field terminates to zero? So, but you can solve it, it's possible. So we first started doing some simulation just based on a hunch that it should work. So this is a proposed structure, silicon on silicon dioxide for surface normal reflector. And we got some simulation results that looks really quite decent. I think 30% delta lambda over lambda. But this paper, we first submitted to a conference, IEEE LEO's annual meeting, got rejected. That conference never rejected a paper before. Just we were like the first one or something like that. So because they said, well, it looks too ordinary, like there's nothing new. So we went on. We went on and filed a patent, and this is a tunable filter. But I'll tell you a little bit about the physics and what's new and how new it is. So what's new is the following. First of all, this grating is really very thin. It's about 10% to 1 lambda. So very thin. So it, converting into the actual numbers, typically we work with 100 to 200 nanometer. And if the refractive index is fully high-index material, fully surrounded by a low-index medium, then something interesting happens. If you look at lambda over the period, less than 1, you say, okay, that's high school physics, diffraction equations applies. If it's larger than 1, the structure is so small, it's like average index. Again, people know that. But in between 1 and the refractive index of this medium, it's actually a very new regime. It's very close to Mie scattering, except Mie scattering was assuming very small delta n and had a lot of assumptions in it. And so we had to really finally solve it properly. But in any case, first initial simulation, we got a very broad band, 1 octave broad band, or you can get some really funny resonances, which we didn't know whether it was noise or not. So I would ask the student to go back and increase resolution and so on. It would never converge. Then you didn't know whether it was real or not. And the difference between these two plots is just simply the thickness of the grating. The other parameters are a small variation. So we said, okay, at least thickness and index contrast seem to play a major role here, and that you actually eventually should be able to design. So I want to say just one word about the comparison with photonic crystal. Of course, at that time, 2004, 2003, already there is substantial research and theory and analysis and experiments on photonic crystal. And we have nothing, we have everything common, right? It's just periodic structure. In fact, it's even 1D. But the difference is that our incidence angle and excitation is indeed very different. First of all, it's surface normal or escape cone. So if you actually look at a typical photonic crystal, Kx, this is in the direction of periodicity and the vertical direction, of course, energy. And you look at the stop band and so on, we are really way out here because we are at Kx equals zero, which didn't have any information really using photonic crystal analysis. This was, I'm talking about 2003, 2004. And so it's really important for us to understand how to design it and how to intuitively come up with structures. And furthermore, for VCSELs, it's very important to actually know the magnitude and phase of the reflection and transmission. So we went ahead and tried to solve it. And after a long story, we finally were able to solve it, actually with textbook equations. So how did we solve it? Well, this is our structure, right? We still assume infinitely periodic and infinitely long bars. And it's very thin, as I mentioned. But we could treat it as a very thick grating in the first place. So they are like slab waveguides. These are your whatever the course number it is, the first chapter, right? Slab waveguide. And you solve slab waveguide. Turns out the index contrast is so large, the array of slab waveguide and single slab waveguide solutions basically the same, except for the below the light line, actually. And there's huge wavelength or frequency range that you have only two modes, two propagation modes in the z direction, in the thickness direction. So what are the two modes looking like? Well, the fundamental mode looks like this, sinusoidal inside, exponentially outside. The first higher order even mode, you have a zero crossing here, it's sinusoidal and exponential outside. They look quite alike, but they are eigenmodes, so they don't talk. And if you actually add on boundary conditions of the abrupt interface at the entrance and the abrupt interface at the bottom, then they mix. They mix, and they mix actually quite well. The coupling is between the two is very good if you design it properly. So turns out this signature can be seen from here. So this is a contour plot for surface normal plane wave. And red is one, a reflection of one, and zero, blue is zero. And horizontal axis is basically wavelength divided by period. So you cut a horizontal line, that's your reflectivity spectrum. Vertical direction is thickness normalized by period. And there's one additional parameter we are kept as a variable, that's duty cycle. So if you actually look at this, there's a very regular checkerboard pattern, which means very nice interference between two modes. And indeed, from this boundary condition of cutoff of the beta modes, you can see that. And then furthermore, if you take a common thickness, after all, it should be a flat region, a flat layer. So take a cut, you can get a Brabant high reflection, or you take another cut by designing these curves, you can get air coating. And then finally, if you choose well in these regions where they cross, not every single crossing works, but if they cross, then that's your high Q resonator. Now, this is a high Q resonator without mirrors. It's just one single layer. It doesn't require Fabry-Perot. It's a transverse mode coupling. So we think it's much more than Faraday in that sense because it's either a resonator, reflector, or AR coating. Now, this this crossing portion, we call it anti-crossing. I won't get into the physics, but you can see that this is FDTD simulation. Dashed line is where the silicon bar is, cross-sectional. And in this particular simulation, we can get a Q of 10 to the 7th. And in another crossing, this is a different order. They have crossing. They don't couple, meaning the transverse mode didn't couple. So in which case, there's not much intensity amplification inside the bars. You get high reflection. So this is how you would design it and get a variety of different behavior. Most important thing is that Behind this chart, there's also a phase. I'm not showing it here, but there is a phase map where you can get high reflection but designable return phase, and or you can get transmission phase. So it's really very interesting. So we can use it, replacing it in a VCSEL to make as a VCSEL reflector, or you can actually the reflection works at incident wave at the inclined angle as well. So we can use it to make hollow core waveguide. In this particular case, an IBM group did it with silicon dioxide on silicon, so they etch vertical bars, and so the laser cavity they made was in the horizontal direction. They fill in some organic material in the optically pumped laser. This is Army Research Lab, Weiming Zhou's work for hollow core waveguide. Recently, Jim Harris actually made a slack on a chip using hollow core waveguide guided by high contrast grating. And the reason why they want to do slack on a chip, of course, to reduce slack, but to using optical beam to amplify e-beam or to accelerate e-beam. So that's really interesting. We can turn the beam direction as well. We can design a broadband surface normal to waveguide coupler with about 97% efficiency. This is simulation. We haven't really reduced to practice yet. But a group at HP Labs that time, David Fatal, actually did a reverse. What he designed was a coupler for in-plane light, and he designed several couplers, nine couplers for different angle. So with this, he made a 3D display. Basically, this can be directly put onto an LCD display, and he has a startup company called Lia, and I saw the demo. I think it's really quite cool. As I mentioned, that high contrast grating can be made into resonator. So we have made something on silicon, not very high Q, only a few thousand, but we made biosensor modulators and wavelength converter. I will cover a little bit later today. And also diffraction can be engineered, and I will cover that in a moment. But phase, optical phase, is actually very, very interesting. As I mentioned, the reflection phase can be actually designed and changed. This is single epi, this is not experimental work, but our theory work, where you use same epitaxy, but just writing the grating, different dimension to get different wavelength emission of VCSEL. But recently, Anders Larsen's group has demonstrated multi-wavelength VCSEL with this technique. The phase can actually be leveraging a hollow core waveguide to be engineered enough to slow down light or to make a very compact switch between two waveguides. Now imagine you have two parallel waveguides. They are guided by these reflectors, high contrast grating, which are extremely thin, 0.1, 0.2 lambda thin. And so therefore, two waveguides can be so close to each other, two waveguides, maybe 5 microns apart. They can be only 0.1 lambda apart. So therefore, making a switch within a much smaller range is easier. And finally, you can use it to make a high numerical aperture lens, 0.9 numerical aperture. We simulated. We proposed this design, and recently Capasso's group has done a fairly similar work. And yes, almost, yeah. And finally, something really quite interesting is that one laser can have two far field output. Far field beam pattern. This is a single mode laser, single frequency, but because the output high contrast grating as a reflector, the transmission can have an interesting phase for the transmission portion. So therefore, it can be acting as a phase plate. So 2D, of course, is even more exciting, I think. Lots of different type of design. Andre Farallon at Caltech has been working on lenses that can be polarization insensitive and different structure that he used to solve the chromatic dispersion and a few other work. And we are working on possibility to create a hologram using, because each structure itself can be acting as a local reflector or resonance to provide phase.
How lossy are
these? If the material itself doesn't have loss, then there's very little. That's right. Right. Yes. Yes. And recently, Federico Capasso published a paper where he actually started with meta surface using metal. And so he calls it meta surface. And we started with dielectric. We call it meta structures. But it's pretty much the same thing, just using refractive index difference. Anyway, so let me then go on to talk about these four topics a little bit. The application of the simple grating, if you will, simple high contrast grating. The first one is, of course, to prove it can have 99.5% reflection for a VCSEL. If on paper, on simulation, it looks good, doesn't mean that you can reduce to practice. Particularly if you put on top of a VCSEL, that the spontaneous emission aperture is so close to the mirror that it has a lot of incident angle, while our simulation and analytical solution all assume zero degree, surface normal. So this was basically requires some belief, so to say, a great leap of faith. Mike Kwong, my former student, really took on this upon himself, and he managed to do that. I have to say that he had a lot more faith in this than myself, actually, in the beginning, because he would fabricate two runs and three runs and didn't work. And we didn't know whether it was the physics that didn't work or whether it's just fabrication. But anyway, he did manage to get it to work. I believe this structure, by the way, can be very, very low threshold current, although we didn't really push for it yet. And then it's single mode. So the high contrast grating here is basically single crystalline material, aluminum gallium arsenide. And you have a gallium arsenide material, a gallium arsenide layer as a sacrificial layer underneath. Once you write the grating, you do selective etching to remove that gallium arsenide layer. So everything is single crystal. And now, given that delta N is very large between the bars and air, we had constantly argued that the tolerance, the fabrication tolerance, should be rather large. But of course, we have to prove it. So the proof came to this particular incident when Mike Kwong is ready to graduate. So I asked him to transfer the technology to the next student. And the next student, by the way, was already fourth year, so he was already very well-trained in the clean room and so on and so forth, just not this particular processing. So we figured it would be no problem. But this was the first device that he fabricated, so apparently harder than we imagined. But at the same time, Mike Kwong was already ready to go. So Chris was very, very upset. And so I said, well, go ahead and measure it and see what you actually get, and we can learn from it. So he measured quite a few lasers laced. I cannot guarantee the yield. The yield is low, but quite a few lasers did lace. And so with that, we say that it's actually quite high in terms of tolerance. Next experiment we did was to figure out how small can you push the grating, because simulation is infinite, right? So we did a 12 micron by 12 micron, 6 micron by 6 micron, and 4 micron by 4 micron. It still worked. By the way, this is TM grating, meaning it's designed for polarization orthogonal to the grating. And TE grating dimensions are quite different. It's much, much thinner. So this is for A50 nanometer. Actually, the TE grating is only about 100 nanometer thin. So anyway, 8 micron, 6 micron, and finally, 4 periods only worked already. And so with that, basically, we say that you really don't need so many bars. Given that this grating is freely suspended, obviously that leads to the next topic. It's a really good segue into the next topic, which is wavelength engineering. So a long time ago, when I first started working on VCSEL, I realized that a small thickness change in the VCSEL can change the wavelength. And if we could do that, we can make multiple wavelengths array. But turns out this is really difficult to control and repeatably reduce into practice. When I went to Stanford in 94 or 92, we started therefore looking into possibility of integrating the top mirror onto a MEMS structure. Again, this is all DBR structure or all single epitaxy. And if we have a selective removable layer and making the top DBR onto another PN junction onto a MEMS structure, then by applying voltage, the top DBR can be moved towards it. The cavity thickness can be changed. Then the laser emission wavelength can be changed. So we that time demonstrated 32 nanometer or so tuning range at 300 kilohertz. At the same time, about a year or so later, Jim Harris' group also demonstrated a dielectric mirror. Initially, it was dielectric plus metal, but later on became dielectric using surface micromachining technique, meaning that layers are deposited later. It's not all semiconductor. The advantage of this structure is that, of course, you can reduce it to any wavelength very easily, while here we require semiconductor. So there are some pros and cons. And I already mentioned Previan. Recently, they have certainly, this is your paper, right? So certainly fantastic results on the MEMS VCSEL for OCT. I did not include your OCT data here, but certainly fantastic. And so the structure shown here, I think this is one such example. They have used gallium arsenide and oxidized aluminum arsenide for mirror, and optically pumped at 1300 with 120 nanometer sweep at 100 kilohertz rate, and electrically pumped, able to get 64 nanometer range and 150 kilohertz rate. And with this kind of wide tuning range and very fast tuning rate, this made it possible to in the OCT arena to see deeper structure. This is also, by the way, I should say, this is a coherent source versus other lasers which are less coherent. So really enabling technology. So we are very interested in this topic as well. And so our entrance point first is to look at that tuning speed, because now we are using high contrast grating, so everything is much smaller. So can we improve on the tuning speed? So shown here is an SEM picture of one of our earlier device. This is all semiconductor DBR selectively etched away. So you see the DBR is 2.5 micron thick. So as a result, the cantilever is 200 micron long, 15 micron wide, very large. But if you reduce the thickness of the grating of the mirror top reflector, everything else can be reduced. And reduced structure is a lighter structure, and lighter structure is more agile. So the agile structure allows you to be 100 times faster. So we have demonstrated 27 megahertz on one of the structures, albeit that's a very small MEMS, so the tuning range in that particular case is small, but on the average, we should be able to go to between 1 to 10 megahertz. So the fast sweeping rate basically allows you to look at larger field of view when you are doing the OCT laser wavelength swept source allows you to test one depth, but you need to scan two-dimensional. So if the sweep rate is fast, then you can cover in real time larger field of view. So now let me switch back a little bit to 1.55 micron. Because after all, our initial idea was to replace, to make single crystal, single epitaxy structure, 1.55 micron pixel. So we indeed were able to do that, and we are able to get tunable continuous tuning range, about 26 nanometer. And the former students, Mike and Chris and Frank, then decided to form a company. So they make transceiver, the 10 gigabit transceiver, 16 channels right now, continuous tuning, and 10 kilometer reach, and all of that in less than 1 watt power consumption. Important thing is it's stable wavelength, so every voltage they dial in, they can get the same wavelength. And they are getting some sampling right now in data center and mobile front haul applications, the mobile phone antenna communications, because nowadays everybody access so much data, it really actually requires fiber communications, low cost fiber communications as well. So moving back to 1060, our first recent try is to get be able to get about 40 nanometer tuning, and this laser works CW, room temperature, high temperature operation, and with 1.15 megahertz of sweep rate. And most recently, we are able to get a continuous tuning, continuous sweeping of 73 nanometer from a single laser using high contrast grating. This is using electrically pumped and delta lambda over lambda, in this case is 6.9% now. We think we are just slightly higher than the record delta lambda over lambda now. It's continuous sweeping without mode hopping or hysteresis. And so with that, we have demonstrated quite a few different wavelength range. And probably the most interesting one in the future is the 2D grating. Normally, people did 2D metastructures or metasurface in a rod form, which makes it very difficult to integrate into a device or MEMS. And we recently made this laser work. And with this, we should be able to control the MEMS behavior a lot better. So I'm eager to try to push that. So. Now, a slightly different angle to this tunable VCSEL is that now that we have gotten the high contrast grating mirror being so light, so small, the question is, can the photon pressure be large enough to make it oscillate? In fact, about 20 years ago, when I first started working on MEMS VCSEL, Bob Bayer asked me that question. He said, why don't you take a look at this? He was working on LIGO. He said, you know, photon pressure should move it. That time our mirror was too heavy. We didn't really see anything. When we have this small and picogram mirror, we decided to take a look. And from a practical point of view, it's also desirable because it can push the mirror going up instead of only coming down. So we look at that. And so this is one of our 1.55 micron VCSEL. The mirror is actually, in this case, quite large, about 16 micron by 16 micron. So it's quite heavy, actually. Inside SEM, it looks like this, very nice. Now we turn on the laser, and it's still inside the SEM. So inside vacuum, the laser is CW operation. And from this stroboscope image, you can measure the width, the oscillation, actually. This arrow is, it should be this between here and here, and as well as its frequency. So we saw the photon pressure initiated self-oscillation. And this is the first active device with optomechanics. And we then went on and did time-resolved spectral measurement. And indeed, we can see the laser going up and down. We, based on this frequency for this particular MEMS, it's a fundamental mechanical speed at 125 kilohertz. When the laser actually emits multi-transverse mode, it can excite higher order MEMS mode. It's actually very interesting and higher. It can be easily much higher speed, 10 times the speed. Now the tuning range in this case is about 23 nanometer, which corresponds to the 600 nanometer physical space. The reason is this is a 1.55 micron VCSEL. The cavity, effective cavity length is rather long because of the DBR, the 60 pairs of DBR. So as a result, the longitudinal mode is 20, mode number is about 26. So you don't get the full benefit of the physical movement. But nevertheless, we are excited about this because the physical movement, 600 nanometer, is much, much larger, three orders of magnitude larger than the traditional optomechanics. The traditional optomechanics, Oscar and Oscar Painter, Professor Painter and Professor Karen Vahala have seen at Caltech, were using resonator. Which is a Faber-Perot resonator or a resonator or a Faber-Perot cavity, where it's a passive device. So therefore, the movement they saw are on the order of angstrom. So we think this is interesting, and we are interested in further pursuing it to cool it, actually. Now let me switch to yet a different, slightly different topic, which is phase engineering. Phase engineering is actually interesting because just now I mentioned that reflection phase can be designed. Actually, it's designed by the bar width, actually duty cycle. So if we use that map I showed earlier on for infinitely periodic structures, and then I just extract that data and cut and paste different periods in here, and following a trace of the phase, reflection phase, I can actually make a lens or a reflection focusing reflector. So this is the FDTD simulation. As I mentioned, there's other groups that actually demonstrated recently lens work, including Fairlong's work from Caltech and Federico Capasso. So clearly it can be engineered. But very recently, we used high contrast grating as an output far field manipulator. In this particular case, different gratings dimensions were used. These are all single mode devices, single transverse mode, single longitudinal mode from the spectrum and so on. And far field from the bottom is actually single lobe Gaussian beam. But the top can have a variety of different beam pattern depending on the design, again, depending on the phase, particularly phase as a function of incident angle. So then let me move on to tell you a little bit about our work on resonator. This is a silicon on silicon dioxide high contrast grating. The resonator is designed only to have about 1,000 or so Q And so for surface normal beam, it's very easy to couple in. And the moment that you bind materials, say antibody antigen binding, it would change the optical thickness of its surrounding, and the wavelength would shift. And depending on the concentration of the antigen used, you would have different layer, different thickness of capture. So here we show experimental data as a function of wavelength shift as a function of concentration of a particular a protein. In this case, it's called troponin I. It's a biomarker for heart attack and stroke. And we show the purified curve, as sensitive as to 100 picogram per milliliter. We also show that you can use serum and pretty much repeating the same curve. The advantage of this structure is it can be scaled. And it doesn't need to be silicon, but silicon is quite nice to use. And it can be any wavelength. In this case, we use, I think, 1.55 micron. So very easily made and very easily coupled. Using the same resonator, we now put a graphene on top and put electrodes on top. Now graphene, of course, single layer graphene has only 2.7% change of absorption. But if it's coupled into with a resonator, you can actually get and you apply bias to change that resonator wavelength, you can get large enough extinction ratio. Good news is that this is surface normal, right? Numerical aperture 0.1 is good enough to couple. We demonstrated 1 megahertz speed, and monolithic array over 200 nanometer range. Finally, that same resonator, this student only fabricated once, and he went ahead and published 3 papers. And so this same resonator, we can get four-wave mixing effect as well. And so here's the pump and signal and eye blur. The coupling efficiency is very high. It's about 87%. And so as a result, at very low pump rate, power, 0.9 milliwatt, we can get conversion efficiency of minus 19.5 dB. None of these is optimized, really, frankly. And if it were optimized, particularly on the fabrication side and so on and so forth, I think the potential is much, much larger. So finally, last example, let me go to diffraction. So we show this map as a design guideline, usually looking at this nice checkerboard pattern for high reflection. And so and we look at this region for in the diffraction zone. Typically, we say, it's ugly, neglected. So one of my students, however, said, OK, I like to look into it. So what he did is he looked into that. And this is the case where the period is smaller period. Wavelength is larger, so therefore there's diffraction water. You have a minus one water. So it turns out, because of the high index contrast, you can actually cancel largely a lot of the higher water, a lot of other direction of mode, and in this case, get primarily R minus one. So therefore, anonymous reflection, or you can get T minus one, and pretty broad band also, and anonymous refraction. Most people thought only plasmonics have such characteristics. Actually, dielectric can do that as well. So with that, we then went ahead and fabricated using silicon, SOI, to design different colors. And this is a 2 centimeter by 2 centimeter rendition of this array. And if you look into it, it basically consists of many of the 100 micron by 100 micron pixels. And we made it into MEMS structure, so it can be uplifted by PDMS, by stamping. So once we stamp it out. This is yet another template. The idea is that these, because it's high contrast grating, dimension is rather large, right? Period is about between 0.5 to 0.7 micron. So it's UV lithography stepper allowed and sizable, so we can get reflection as we like. And if we put onto PDMS, we stretch the period, we can get a beam scanning devices. And so this is theory, and this is the experiment. And so beam steering device, and here we stretch only 5%, but ideally you can stretch over 50% to get much larger. Finally, then we made this structure. This is our design, and this is the experiment. And by stretching it, you can see the color, and this is basic. This is following the principle of a chameleon, actually. And so at the same time, when we published the paper, there was another paper studying the real animal chameleon. So KQED became interested in. With that, I basically conclude my talk. I think the way to go, at least one of our future direction, is actually to stacking it. So sort of following that line of suggestion of the reporter, it is really exciting, actually, to stack different designs, whether it's to make lenses or to make microscope, flat microscope. And so potentially layering different designs for different colors and so on, and being able to flexibly stretch them. And then following that, maybe possibility to explore more about the resonators, adding on, say, quantum dots or erbium or whatever that's interesting gain material inside would be really desirable. And finally, looking into the nonlinear property of this high contrast grating resonator. Again, the idea is we just took the simplest path. We didn't really tailor the bars or matching the field. If we had done that, and hopefully in the future we'll do that, then I think we can actually get much, much better coupling efficiency and nonlinearity, wavelength conversion, and so on and so forth. So with that, I thank you very much for your attention, and I welcome collaboration.
Phenomenal. Very, very nice talk. Very impressive. Questions? Yes.
Thank you. So the question is about sensitivity to temperature, to thermal effect. For the mirrors, because it's broadband reflector, or even for anti-reflection, it's not going to be sensitive at all. But for the resonator, it will, because there you are really looking at very narrow, particularly if it's high Q.
Other questions? Chang.
One D grating is easier to fabricate. At least my students told me that. It's also shorter e-beam time. That's what they told me too. So when we first started making the 2D, you know, the exposure and so on and so forth seemed to be, they had a lot of issues. Again, you know, this is just, we took the easiest way out in terms of escape road. but not yet optimizing the performance. But I think there's a lot of meat still to a lot of things to harvest.
Other questions? Yeah, Demis.
Excellent. Thank you very much for that question. I did not make it clear. It's the vacuum. So the high contrast grating mirror is highly damped. So therefore, if you don't package it in vacuum, you don't see that Q resonance. And when we put it into SEM, we saw the effect. But it can be designed for it then, therefore. So that's why going into the 2D structure, why we were going to the 2D, because when we go to the 2D, we can then tweak the Q, mechanical Q, and make it better to oscillate.
And what's the highest Q you've been getting, mechanical Q you've gotten to?
In air, something like maybe 5 or so, not very high. But in vacuum, of course, it can be very high.
Other questions? All right, one last question. Go ahead.
What about the mechanical stability?
Ah.
In some cases, like the LIDAR, the rest will be placing the planes or others.
Yeah, mechanical stability actually is very good because this thing is very, very robust. I typically show people a cut up model. If you look at the aspect ratio, and even thinking about stainless steel, you can see how stiff it is. Long time ago, we did a lot of experiment with G, 10G or 20G dropping, and see its oscillation. It's really stable. But what is really interesting, however, is it does, if it's inside particularly low vacuum, not even high vacuum, low vacuum, then you can see the photon pressure to push it. Its photon pressure is more than gravity in that sense.
All right, let's thank Connie again.